Hello and welcome. I'm Arpit Sharma, Product Manager, Mechanical Expansion Valve in Danfoss Cooling that go into refrigeration and air conditioning applications. And today I have the pleasure to have with me Gustavo.
Hello, my name is Gustavo Fernandez and I am Director of Product Management in Danfoss Cooling. And my responsibility is line components for commercial refrigeration and air conditioning.
Gustavo, I've been getting a lot of questions from our customers and sales regarding our ultra low GWP refrigerants. And today I would like to ask these questions to you and get some answers.
Okay, please go ahead. This is a topic that really excites me.
So. Great. So I'm going to start with our CO2 portfolio. Last year you released a GBCT ball valve. So if you could tell us a little bit about the GBCT ball valve, and also, what's the difference between GBC, GBCH, and GBCT ball valves?
Yes, that is correct. So last year we launched this new product, the GBCT, which is released for transcritical CO2. So it's a ball valve capable of withstanding 140 bars. And the difference with the other products is that we have our traditional GBC, which is then released to 45 bars. And then we have the GBCH released to 90 bars. And now finally, we have completed the portfolio with the GBCT. So now we have the full range. So our customers can purchase ball valves at Danfoss for CO2.
That's great. I want to follow that up with another question on the ball valve, the GBCT. And that is, what is the difference between the GBCT ball valve from Danfoss versus the other ball valves that are out there in the market?
Yes. So the product has been specially designed for CO2, and it's available on all connections up to 218 inches. So basically, it covers the full range, and it's also available with and without access port. So the products are fulfilling all the customer requirements. At the same time, it's specifically designed for CO2, and that means that the ceilings and the seats inside of the valve have a very long time life. They have a long life expectancy. And what is most important, it is designed with a bleed port. So there is no liquid, CO2 liquid entrapped inside of the valve when the valve is in a closed position. And this is a common market failure of some of our competitor products, which we have solved in Danfoss with our new GBCT ball valve.
That's great. And I think this is also the ball valve that is in our Optima CO2 condensing unit.
Yeah, that's right. This is the best CO2 ball valve in the market. So of course, we want to put it in our own Optima ICO2 condensing unit.
Great. And now switching to a question related to another product, and that is the CCMT. Mm-hmm. So I know we released another newer version of CCMT. Mm-hmm. So if you could tell what is this new version all about and how is it different than the existing CCMT?
Yeah, so you can see here, this is our traditional CCMT. Which is the market leader because it offers a lot of benefits for the customer. And this is the new product that we have released, which is the new platform, which is equivalent to the CCMT, and it also has some extra benefits. So basically, we have been taking all the benefits and all the experience in this product and build it into a smaller and lighter platform, which, as you can understand, we can offer to our customers to a very competitive price. And this is, of course, the best benefit for the customer. But it's not only that. It's a very robust product, very resistant to dirt. So they are not going to have problems to have to call technicians to clean the filters or because the valve is sticking. At the same time, it's delivered in an open position. So it can be welded directly without wasting time in production. And it is serviceable. So you can remove this cartridge here on the top and just put a new cartridge in case that something goes wrong, and this will make service very fast and reduce the downtime for the system. So all in all, this product has a better OPEX and a better CAPEX than the predecessor, and that is the reason why the customer should convert.
Great, so we've really taken a customer-centric approach mm-hmm. in designing this new product.
Yes.
What more products can I and our customers foresee in the future in the CO2 portfolio?
Yeah, very good question. So as you know, in Danfoss, we are committed to develop all the portfolio for CO2. And in this area, we are working on different products. But the one that excites me most at the moment is the pressure switch. So currently, we are developing a pressure switch for transcritical CO2. So it has a maximum working pressure of 143 bars. And we have been already providing some samples to some of our customers that have validated the product and they are ready to buy. So now we are just building our final manufacturing facility and we are going to release this product very soon. As you can see, it's a fantastic product because basically, apart from covering the high pressure, it has a PED category 4 approval, so the customers do not need to ask for dispensations anymore. It has a very high contact rating, yeah. CEF 6 FLA for the entire range of the product, as well as very short connections to make it very compact. And what is most important, the set point of the product is made in the factory, and this makes it very stable over time, so the customers do not need to reset or recalibrate the product during the manufacturing of the unit or during the operation.
Yeah, another product with customer at the center when developing it.
Yes. And now that we are talking a little bit about CO2, let me ask you one question.
Sure.
So why should the customers use AKBP instead of other stepper motor valves in display cabinets?
Interesting question. Now, AKBP, as you can see here, it's a normally closed valve, which means that if you have a power loss and there is no power backup, the valve will close, which makes sure that there is no liquid going back into the compressor and thereby protecting the compressor and the system. At the same time, service is a very important element when it comes to food retail applications. So with an AKVP valve, it's easy to service. You just have to open it up, take the filter out using this tool, blow the dirt away, close it back, and your valve is serviced. And the third advantage you have on the product is that since it's pulse modulating valve, it has a better heat transfer across the evaporator, which makes sure that the system efficiency is always high.
Wow. That was actually a very fast service, I will say. Yeah. But Arpit, shouldn't we talk a little bit about A2L?
Absolutely. I think A2Ls are as important as CO2 is for the refrigeration guys.
Good. So tell me then, which are the latest A2L refrigerants that the portfolio is qualified for?
Well, the list is long, but to break it down and condense it, I would say that when it comes to R410A scroll systems, we are seeing R32, R454B, and R452B as the future refrigerants. Our portfolio is qualified for that. And when it comes to R134A screw and centrifugal systems, we are seeing R1234ZE as the future refrigerant. And our portfolio is qualified for that as well. When it comes to refrigeration, we are seeing many options that both non-flammable and flammable that can replace 134A. And that's where we see that R455A, R454C, and R1234YF making a move in the market, and our portfolio is qualified for that.
Okay, very good. That was a very complete answer, but also a little bit complex. So if some of our customers out there want to know if one specific product is approved for one specific refrigerant, what should they do?
The easy and simplest way to check it is to go to Danfoss Cool Selector 2, select the product, select the refrigerant, and you will have your answer. If you don't find a product that is qualified for that refrigerant, then contact Danfoss. And this is true for valves, sensors, condensing unit, compressors, all our products.
Okay, I understand. But tell me, why do we talk so much about qualification for A2L? What is so complex?
The complexity comes in with the detail that is there in the process. So first, we need to decide and select what refrigerants we want to qualify our products for. Then we need to look at a material compatibility test of every part in the product that comes in contact with the refrigerant. In parallel, then we need to look at, what are the different approvals we need to get the product qualified, you know, like the PED in Europe, the UL in the US. And lastly, we also need to see that we have the manufacturing capability to produce these products. For example, mechanical expansion valve here, a T2, the bulb charge is very unique for a particular refrigerant. So we need to make sure that, you know, we have the capability to produce this bulb charge. And I think a combination of all this process is what makes it a bit complex.
Okay, I understand. I can see that you have been bringing with you a T2 with flare connectors. So tell me, what is Danfoss position regarding the use of flare connectors with A2L refrigerants?
Yeah. So historically speaking, we recommended solar connectors for A2L refrigerants. But legally now, it's allowed to use flare connectors, and our portfolio is approved for it. However, from an environmental standpoint, it's better to use solar connectors. And also in certain countries, like the Netherlands, use of flare connectors on A2L refrigerants is illegal.
Okay, I understand.
Now, I would like to ask you one question about A2L and the pressure switches. Uh-huh. Where are we on that?
Okay, so for pressure switches for A2L, we have basically three solutions for our customer. We have our portfolio of ACB cartridge switches, which on the waterproof version IP65 can be used with any A2L refrigerant. We also have a product family that is called KPE, which was specifically designed for A2Ls, but in this case, we recommend that our customers are using it together with a center barrier or with a similar method to limit the current and the power to the pressure switch. And finally, they can use our standard KP pressure switches, but in that case, they need to get their unit validated by a third party.
Great. Hmm? And now, $1 million question for you, Gustavo, and that is, which is the refrigerant for the future?
Okay, yeah, and that is indeed a $1 million question, but as you know, we do not believe that there is only one refrigerant for the future. Selecting the right refrigerant requires that our customers are thinking about different factors like the safety, the environment, and also the specific application. So what we have done in Danfoss is we have selected the refrigerants that we believe are sustainable for the future, and we have developed our portfolio of products so we cover those refrigerants. In any case, if you or our customers are interested to learn more about it, we have a lot of articles and videos on our webpage, refrigerants.danfoss.com. And also here in Cooling United, we have some specific sessions about refrigerants. So I will invite everyone to join those sessions if they want to learn more about it.
Great. Thank you, Gustavo. Mm-hmm. Always a pleasure talking to you. And for our viewers, if you may have any questions, we'll be happy to answer that in the chat room. Thank you.
Thank you.